Hello, everyone. Happy Wednesday. And if you're not watching this on Wednesday, just happy day to you. Today, I'll be drawing a student learning magic in the library. So let's get to it.
All right. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Let's Draw number 5. I am inking a studious student learning magic in the library. So one of the things I'm trying to do is get a little faster with these. I'm trying to start opening up more room to start working on comic pages on the side. Not last week, but the week before. No, last week I actually had a nice relaxing, like normal weekend. Oh my god. The week before though, that was interesting. That was me stretching my legs. Literally and figuratively. Let's see. 2 weeks ago I had website launch with YouTube channel. Like, you know, I had to get everything I worked on for the last 5 months finally together and out in the world for you all to for your all's enjoyment. And need to get that out. Released everything on Wednesday that week, and then that Friday I had Silicon Valley Comic Con. It was the first one of that. Used to be Big Wow, and then they got Big Wow partnered up. Steve Wozowski? I don't know. Some smart tech guy. And that Facebook dude. terrible with names. Good with faces. Terrible with names. So I had a table at show. It was a Friday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. But no, I thought it'll be great. It's like, hey, Robin, why don't you run a marathon on Sunday? Oh yeah, that would just be wonderful. It's just how the timing worked out. I didn't realize I've been into running for the last 3 years. Started off with at like just 1 mile, barely making a mile. Did the Couch to 5K app, great app. Recommend it if you want to get into running. It'll get you from running 1 mile to running 3 miles. I feel like that was harder to do than training for the marathon in some instances. What else? But yeah, so I trained up for the marathon. Made the decision about 6 months ago, and was just training. Oh, and then I saw the date of it. I was like, wait, that date sounds familiar. And I saw that it was the same date for Silicon Valley Comic Con weekend. Like, oh no. Create my own like weird art, artist like Iron Man. It's like you must attend a convention and run a marathon. I wanted to attend Sunday for the last of the show for Silicon Valley Comic Con, but after running the marathon, my body was like, no way, Jose. I really love attending conventions. I actually enjoy the getting nervous about like the commission aspect of it, but then once I get like on a roll with them, it's quite fun actually. All right, what else has happened for the Patreon supporters? Thank you so much. You all are awesome. It helps out a lot. If y'all don't know, Patreon is a way for you to support creators. It's like Kickstarter, but it's ongoing. So I just have like, it's like you only have to be, if you want to do it, a dollar donation a month is, yeah, like it's really all I'm expecting. So yeah, just trying to reinforce that lighting with the shading, of course. Also the direction of how to mark the lines, helps reinforce that like directional, like if you want that energy. So I put a lot of my hatching, especially on his body, like radiating away. you especially want to go as you get closer to a light source. The contrast actually is greater. And then it's going to be like a lot darker around here. And then as like, you know, get out to here, it's not as, the impact of the light is not as great. So containment lines, the outline around an object, it's going to be a little thicker. Well, technically it doesn't. Traditionally it is. I've seen some folks get away with, they'll have an even containment line everywhere, and they can get away with it because they have like a better design and composition that helps reinforce that. So, you know, you can still tell what's happening. Wrinkles, I mean, the reason why they make you learn to draw the human body first, so if you're going through art school, or if you're studying on your own, definitely learn how to draw the body without clothes. Because clothing just informs form. Because a lot of people who don't understand the body, like the clothing will just fall flat. Unless somehow you can work out a style that can work for. Though I just need to be careful about not smearing my hand over everything. I'm really bad about that. Like, I'm not very good at systematically, like, start in the top right corner and then work your way down. Like, one of the few things that just did not click for me. I'm like, no. I'm gonna work on what's important first. That I deem important, I guess. Yeah, if y'all want to see the past Let's Draws in their final image, you can do that on my website. Just go to my shop, Originals. I mean, you can buy the original there if you want, and that'd be help me out a lot and would be great. But also, you can also find a scan of the image along with the picture of the original, because you only get partial constantly, so it's kind of a interesting format. Explains why a lot of people work horizontally on a lot of these art demos, but you know what, comics, they're kind of vertical, so I'm trying to stick to that format. I want this, and now I'm like looking at this, I'm gonna try making this higher key, like a lot contrastier, light and dark. And then on this side of the body, as moving away, doing these more like delicate dry brush lines. So right now I'm trying to throw more heavy blacks around him. I gotta figure this one out. Him. That was originally him. Gonna stick to him. Watch me screw that up again, though. Anywho-y. So, yeah. Throwing down more flat blacks, especially around, like, focal points. So, like, his head, so these nails, they got flat around the head, so it frames better. Because there's all, you see that there's just all this gray that's happening right now. So any areas where it's just going to be flat black, it's just going to pop. For the books, so I'm all about texture. Okay, that's something I discovered about myself as I go through to learn my techniques. And I like playing with the materials a lot. What happens when I, like what I do right now, like what happens if I take the brush and drag it and give it a little jiggle? It's like, oh, that's kind of a cool technique. You know, I play around a lot. So for the brush, Oh yeah, and different textures. So different tools, different textures. Also, like how it holds in my hand, how it responds. I'm gonna have a different technique with it. So with the brush, actually have more control over the brush. And I prefer to do that with people. Making sure I have control over the people. And they're nice and like clean. Dirty them up in areas that need to. But you know, it's controlled. It's on purpose. Now when I get to the background, like I noticed like early on that it was actually kind of cool to like use the brush for people and organic stuff. So animals and other organics, and then and then switch over to a nib for the background. Just because the approach is different, it's a contrast. So you'll be able to tell that, oh, there's like a difference. It's still, you know, it's still done in my hand. It'll still feel cohesive. I'm gonna get a different texture from that nib that's gonna differentiate it from like the person. So I got rid of that tone on the lip so it doesn't feel like red lipstick. Yeah, drop the highlight just for a little bit more definition on the nose, and got rid of the eyelashes that are more associated with girls, like the going off to the side there. Now I need to be super careful about that area because it takes a while for the just going through and picking up containment line. So a while back I took one of those tests to see like what house I would be in for if I was like for that Harry Potter universe. It was kind of a 50-50 split on Hufflepuff and Ravenclaw. But due to my answers, it like put me in Hufflepuff. I'm like, that is exactly where I want to be. Because I assume like the Hufflepuff folks are probably more the artists. Come back in with white and crosshatch it to lighten it up. Just like the black, I can layer it. Ah, there's a hair in my nib. There's a hair in my nib. Hope you don't mind the sound of nib scratching, because that's what you're gonna get. I realize, like, watching Bob Ross, like, how, like, it's really cool, like, it's really soothing to hear his brush hit canvas. It's just a soothing sound. And then, when my brush hits paper, you hear nothing. And then, of course, the only other sound you're gonna get is, really nib, and that's more of a high-pitched scratchy. So right now I'm using a Maru nib. I'm gonna have to find a separate link, because most of the links I'm referencing for my materials towards is Blick. But they definitely do not carry Maru nibs and G nibs, which is Japanese made. They're the type of nib you're looking for, and there's different companies that make those types. Just like squiggling the brush to get the texture on the socks, you can squiggle the nib. And if you get even lines, like even space lines, you get like a nice tactile texture. Kind of wanted to be inspired by Harry Potter, but also the Kingkiller Chronicles by forgetting his first name, but Ruthpus, I think his last name. That's really sad that I can't remember his full name. It's awesome, actually. If you're into fantasy series, it's a really good series. First two books are out for it, and a lot of us who are fans of this series are just waiting for the third one to pop. Whenever that's going to happen. Patrick Ruthless. Just remember the author's name of the Kingkiller Chronicles. Yeah, nib's nice on this type of semi-smooth paper because it can take the paper pretty well. But because it has a little texture to it, when I go faster on it, just like the brush, it breaks up the line. So a tangent was happening. I have to go in with a little white and fix it. Tangents are just when lines kind of sync up awkwardly, even though they're supposed to be like separate planarly. So if like I had a line like on a character here coming in, and then there's a line on a book that just so happens to also sync up, it looks like it's a complete line and connects it, even though they're two separate things, and I'm going to break the plane. So that's a tangent. It's lines that sync up awkwardly that flatten out the image. Hard to catch sometimes, especially if you're someone who throws down a lot of marks, like I can do. Yeah, I try not to think too hard when coming up with subjects for these demos. Because how I look at it, I mean, I have to be posting one a week. That's actually a lot of content over time, if you think about it. And I'm going to be evolving and getting better, so I'm like, why worry about it? I mean, like, try to do the best as I can, come up with something entertaining enough. And if I don't get it right this time, get it right the next, work on it. Try to get better the next time. It's actually a better mentality to have if you actually want to get stuff done. Some people psych themselves out by thinking a little too hard on it. So I've been talking to some of my friends who are actually watching these inking demos, and because they want to learn. But yeah, I was just asking them about the format. Do they like it? Or would they like a change? And I want to ask you all, what do you all think about the format? I mean, it can change. It's flexible. Do you want it longer? Do you want it shorter? Would prefer sped up time as opposed to like me cutting? Maybe like I'll speed up my drawing for when I'm not talking, and then like when I do talk, I'll slow it back down to normal speed, and I'll say what I want to say, and then speed it right back up. I think that could be interesting. Ink and a cat, which I'll go back to the brush for. Animals and people, get the brush. Unless I want texture on them. So, of late, people have been approaching me to talk to high schoolers about becoming an animator. Actually, yeah, both students that are going into college, I guess the next term. They wanted to know, they were both going in for animation. My day job is animation. Trying to transition to comics, though. But yeah, they were just wondering. They just wanted to know how Just getting info about surviving as an animator. But it was actually kind of fun, you know, talking to them. And good for them or their parents who decided, it's like, you should probably talk to someone in that field. I totally didn't when I was going into animation. Let's see, my school thankfully had a digital class. I bet this class isn't pretty much in a lot of schools now, but I feel like at the time it was pretty unique. And yeah, we just learned digital art, creating websites. It was a very generalist class. Learning Photoshop. It was pretty much graphic design class. And So I wasn't really thinking about becoming an animator. I didn't think I could do it as a job. I don't know what I was thinking. I guess it just wasn't really, like, it didn't ever even cross my brain that it's like, oh, this is a job that people can do. That you can actually get, like, trained into. I thought it was, like, harder than that. So I didn't bother processing it. But, yeah. I saw a poster in class. Advertised to the school I went to, SCAD, for their animation program. I was like, oh, you can get educated on this stuff. Well, sign me up. Because at the time I was like, oh, maybe I'll go into biology. Go into the sciences. Glad I didn't. Yeah, glad I went to the arts. I pretty much just told the kids that, yeah, you're going to art, but you're going to have to work. It's, being an artist is a tough gig. It's just a lot of upfront work. And it's a skill, so, I mean, gets easier artists just adapt and become more comfortable with, like, the new pressures. Or a combo. What else did I tell them? I kind of told them, like, my background. When I graduated undergrad, I sat in my bathrobe for about 6 months straight on my couch. It was really depressing. Pretty much the only people contact I would would have is, like, go visit Missy and Charlie. Some friends. But they got jobs, so I was kind of jealous of that. Made me realize, like, a couple things, though. One, I'm gonna have to work for it, of course. Two, pretty much no matter where I pretty much got in the habit, no matter where I, or like a promise, no matter where I go, I always work on my own stuff. Because I had to do some stepping stones in order to, but the work I was, you know, doing at those stepping stones wasn't really work that was going to get me to the next stone. The work that got me to the next stone was actually my personal work. So yeah, I recommend working on your own stuff if you can swing it. It's a good habit to get into. Also, if you can make some revenue off of it, it gives you some flexibility and you have choices. I think that's like, for me, that's what I consider like one of the aspects of being wealthy is having options and the choice to not do something. Sometimes people back themselves in corners and they like have to, they have to do work that they don't want to do. Don't we all at first? But over time, you need to really cultivate and really ask yourself where you want to go, who you want to be. The nice thing, like when you do the scratchy method with nib, because nib throws down a bead of ink that sits on top, so brushes throw down like a thinner layer that absorbs faster into the paper, so you can pass your hand over it sooner because it dries faster. But ink kind of nibs throw down a bead of ink, and so if you do lighter scratches to build up the line, those are like smaller beads of ink that will dry faster, as opposed to like putting down a really, really super thick line that will take, that does take forever to dry. I think I'm gonna keep the Maru nib on the books, but anything dealing with the bookcase itself, I'll use the hunt. And sometimes if you want something to feel a part of an object, because usually they're like touching pretty hard. Frazetta did this, and other artists, but like they'll let it, just don't complete the line. So like here I completed it, but it's kind of tilted, so it's not really touching fully. Same here, but these other ones that are, these other books that are touching the bookcase, I'm gonna complete. I'm not gonna finish that line. I'm gonna let them merge with the bookcase. Since I wanted to fade away over here, just giving slight details, just letting it fade. A color artist would hate me right now. I'm guessing, I'm assuming. I colored my own work. Coloring for comics is interesting because, a color artist, if it's a lot easier to color an art from comic artists where, like, they complete their line, they're, like, really clean, and they, like, really, and all their containment lines are nice, and, like, they just connect everything. Yeah. It's a little bit more work on their part if they have to go through and, okay, you can see that, okay. And try to, like, block out all these, like, sketchy lines because they can't paint bucket as easily. But you know what? That's why you pay them. You pay them for the struggle. You say, I'm sorry. And I hope they do a good job and want to work with you again. Starting to get... Sometimes when you're aggressively hatching with a nib tip, especially the Maru, since it's a finer, sharper one, it's going to pick up paper fibers along the way. It's going to mess with the tip. Sometimes I don't mind it because it thickens it up. But yeah, because these lines are so built up, it makes the character lines where I took my time and really smoothed them out, it makes them pop better. It's just contrast. Sometimes if you're going to go just for focal point, I tend to enjoy a detailed, super characteristic background where I just go crazy like this. Keep the character a little bit more simplified. I'm almost done, I pretty much knocked this out in two drawing sessions. That's pretty good. I pretty much have to keep doing that. I have to just start working faster. Like I said, the whole point of these videos is to train me up along the way as I'm teaching you all stuff. All right, so after reviewing this, since I didn't do my thumbnail, that is a very important stage where I figure out my black and white composition, so I know where to throw down the heavy blacks and stay maybe like 80% gray as well. But I didn't do that. I kind of, for this one, I just went straight to sketch, and one of the things that got lost was where to put the heavy blacks. Now, color could save this, but you know, I'm an inker, so I'm gonna try to save it with black. So the heavy blacks, we need to go high contrast. This is a focal point. And I wanna make it feel like there's more light coming off of here. So that means more black along here. And then around here, like really grayed out. I wanna keep the books behind him where they are, because I want him to pop in front of the books. And yeah, I think it's just gonna be some more layering with the nib. So let's see if we can figure this out. Darken up those shells. Those lines are a little too thick that I put down with the Hunt 104. I don't so need. Just gonna use this nib to darken it up and also make it less obvious. Or don't make them stand out as much as individual lines. Sometimes, unfortunately, when I don't plan the black and whites as well, knowing when to stop becomes an issue. Fail to plan, plan to fail. Take it off, Gizmo. My favorite part. A piece of paper that I can use to block. Have to be careful, because there is such thing as too much of a good thing. let that dry, and then have to go back in. White, clean it up.
The inked finger.
Gonna
We're calling it. I
get this at this point. It's just signature.
This is what it used to look like. This is what I started off with. This is what it looks like now. All right.
All right, everyone. That wraps up. Let's draw number 5. Where to put my signature? I know, I'm gonna hide it. I like hiding my signature. I'm gonna put it in the book's signature. And then you get to listen to me go through my little spiel.
Well, I'm letting that dry. All right, here we go. If you can please subscribe to my website's newsletter. Every month, I send out a newsletter the first Monday of the month. And bring that hand back. First Monday of the month, and I will be, as an incentive for those who join my newsletter, I'm giving you a preview of art that it's going to that will be collected into an art book at a later date. So if you want to check that out, please subscribe. And then below that, around here-ish, you got materials. If you want to see what I used and links to where to buy them, go to the blog post of this video on my website. And if you're on my YouTube channel right now, if you go down to into the description, I should have a link for that. Yeah, please check out any of the other videos.
I mean, everything's launched now, thankfully. I have Patreon. That's a great way to support me. And buying merchandise. Those are the two biggest ways you can... That's four, Robin. Two. Those are two of the biggest ways that you can support me and also subscribing. Please subscribe and like and share these videos. It helps out a lot in the whatever YouTube-ish algorithms, and it makes sure that more and more people see my work. Working on trying to figure out comic stuff right now. And we'll keep, I'll inform you what happens with that. And yeah, have a great day.
Stay productive. Double thumbs up. Thanks for watching. And on to the next video.
So this is the first video that I'm introducing the Patreon credits. Thank you for my Patreon supporters. And if you want to support me and you're not a patron yet, please just go check out my Patreon page. It's just Robin Holstein at Patreon. Please sign up, and your name will be on the credits, just like these folks. Thank you. Bye.